Hello and welcome to this inaugural episode of Summary Report by TVC22. I'm your host, Thomas Tochting, and what we'll be doing in this brand new show is taking you through a quick summary of the local council meetings, town hall meetings, and such what. Obviously, this is a summary and a highlight show. It's what we have identified as being some of the more key elements of the meeting that took place. So it is not a full report. If you'd like to see that, you can find it in the link in the description, either above or below, depending on where you're watching. We'll put the agenda and the link to the full meeting as well. So let's crack on and dive in, shall we? So in today's episode, we're going to be looking at the latest municipal council meeting. And as usual, the real meaty stuff occurred in that last hour of live broadcasting during the Committee of the Whole. There were some really professionally presented reports that night, as well as a joke or two cracked here and there, which is always nice to see our local councillors getting along so well. And the bulk of this Committee of the Whole really looked at staff committee reports. As we know, the pandemic is taking a serious financial toll on a lot of individuals, as well as a lot of businesses, and the non-for-profit organisations weren't exempt to these struggles. There was some help, though, this week provided by the council, as the councillors did vote in favour of being able to reimburse non-for-profit organisations who haven't been able to utilise the spaces and buildings that they have been renting since April last year. This move came following letters from Rockland United Soccer Club, as well as the Optimist Club, who are looking at some way to save a little bit of money when they haven't been able to have any revenues for the past 12 months. And Councillor Dombouchard praised the initiative.
Just a commentaire. Je juste vraiment féliciter le département pour cette initiative-là. I think there's a lot of organizations that just, you know, unfortunately weren't unable to do anything. And I look at Rockland United and see what they're asking. They had no season. They had no summer season. They had no winter season. There's just nothing going on for them. We're going to need our community to be strong when they're able to come back. So I think this is just one step. We did this for the Presse Café at the YMCA, so there's no reason we shouldn't do this for volunteer organizations. So I think it's a really good initiative.
The organizations will be credited back to April 2020 and will not have to make any further payments until activities resume once again, which is great news for these non-for-profit organizations, which have essentially been inactive for well over a year now. There was also some changes made to the performance deposit reimbursement criteria for building permits that had been issued across the municipality during the pandemic. Now, what quite does that complicated sentence mean? Well, Bruce de la Cruz, our co-op journalist here at TVC22, sat down with the planning and infrastructure director, Mr. Julian Lenhart at the City of Clarence Rockland, to find out a little bit more information.
In terms of when a builder applies for a building permit, there's a deposit. That's to ensure that the work is done. It's like a guarantee that work is going to be done to the requirements of the permit. So, and so what they're asking for is that there's a 1 year right now, the existing bylaw, after 1 year, there's a 25% deduction on that deposit. That is applied if the construction is incomplete within a 1 year time frame. And so what the builders are asking is that, or the development community, what they're asking is that there's an amendment that's made so that instead of starting to deduct 25% after 1 year, that's delayed to 2 years for multi-use or multi-unit type construction. So which is like your condos, your townhouses, that type of building. So so it would, the 25% deduction of the deposit kicks in after 2 years instead of 1 year.
Do you think they're asking for too much, for too long? Like is 2 years too long or 25%? Who decides all that?
No, well, give you a bit of an idea, we've developed a working kind of or a it's a developer community consultation type meeting, and so it's an annual meeting, and the goal is to be able to try and look at policies that have an that affect and have an impact on the development community, and how can we collectively work together to try and find solutions to maybe some of their issues, some of their challenges, and maybe improving some of our policies so that it addresses, you know, everybody's needs, the communities, the development community's needs, and ours as well. So through that process, the community, the development community informed the city that there were some challenges with the 1 year because of, especially for the multi-unit buildings, because they can't often complete them before the units are purchased. So the exterior is done, but the interior can't be fully completed until the units are sold, so that the new property owners have an opportunity to choose the finishes inside of the building, right? So under those circumstances, the 1 year didn't allow them enough time to be able to finish the construction. So we thought that it was reasonable, and we agreed with them that 2 years would be more suitable. And that's why we made the recommendation to council to amend the bylaw to be able to push for push that 1 year deadline to 2 years before the 25% reduction starts to come into effect.
A multi-use pathway, which is set to join up Caron Street and Amber Street, was back in front of the council this week. The project was granted a green light during the 2021 budget with a approximate cost of $205,000. But this week, what really was going in front of the councillors was to give approval for the city to enter into conversation with Hydro One Inc., who own the land that it's going to be built upon. The agreement simply states that Hydro One will give permission to the city to be able to construct on their land and to build this pathway, and also a promise that it is the city and the Parks and Recreation Department which will maintain it. Earlier in the meeting, Mayor Guy Desjardins spoke about the South Nation Conservation Tree Planting Initiative, which has had some staggering success across our region in the last few years. To find out a little bit more about what's coming up for this year and what's looking like a record-breaking planting season as well, I spoke to Taylor Campbell from SNC.
Welcome to TVC 22 with me, reporter Thomas Stockting. We're here today to talk about a topic that was brought up by Mayor Guy Desjardins in the last council meeting regarding the local tree planting giveaway program to aid municipalities and residents to get involved with actually planting some trees. And this is obviously in partnership with South Nation Conservation, which means that I'm joined by Taylor Campbell once again. How are we doing?
Hey, Thomas, I'm doing well. Yourself?
I'm doing very well. Thank you very much, Taylor. Well, as I said in the little intro there, we're here to talk about the Community Tree Giveaway Program, which Mayor Guy Desjardins mentioned in the last council meeting. Could you explain a little bit about this program, what it is, the background, its purpose, why SNC set it up?
Yeah, absolutely. So right now, residents can go online to register for a chance to receive a free bundle of native and locally sourced tree seedlings. One bundle per household through our community free tree giveaway program. So all you have to do is visit our website at nation.on.ca to access an online form to register your contact information for your chance to receive your bundle of seedlings, which can be picked up at a municipal location later in May. So this is the second year in a row that we administer the community free tree giveaways program, which is actually a partnership that we have with our member municipalities, including the city of Clarence Rockland, to try and increase local forest cover and encourage increased community tree planting. So residents are reminded that completing the online form unfortunately does not guarantee that you will receive free trees, as there are limited amounts available per municipality. In the case of Clarence Rockland, there are about 1,000 trees available, and they are allocated on a first come, first serve basis. But we do encourage you to visit our website, find that form, register your contact information, and hopefully you can receive a bundle of free trees and you can plant them in your backyard or in your woodlot or your forest to help get more trees in the ground.
So people can literally plant them anywhere as well, which is absolutely fantastic. You said a bundle of trees as well. I take it it's not just one tree. Well, I'm British, so whenever I think of tree, I think of the sturdy royal oak. But I take it there's a variety of trees, that seedlings that come in the bundle.
Yeah, so we're talking about tree seedlings. So they're very small. They're not, you know, they're not a potted tree or a caliper-sized tree. So the bundles are actually going to be in groups of five or 10. So if you receive a bundle of 5 or 10 trees, absolutely, you can plant them in your backyard, in your if you have a forest on your property, and hopefully they do take over the summer.
Okay, grand. And because there's a variety of different ones as well, do they require different levels of care? Is there like a little instructions manual that come with it for people? Do they have to water them X number of times a day? I mean, I kill every one of my house plants. That one behind me is fake.
Yeah. Well, first of all, it's important to note that all of the trees available through the giveaways are native species to the region. Second of all, as soon as the tree is planted, we would recommend giving it a healthy dose of water, And if it is a dry summer and a dry spring, similar to what we experienced last year, then I would recommend staying on top of the watering when you can, in the evenings or in the mornings when it's cooler, so that more of that moisture can get into the ground. Just giving it a little spritz of water when you can.
And I know that South Nation Conservation, you guys have a wider tree planting program as well. Does this incorporate into that tree planting program? Are those numbers added to it? And how many trees are coming through the seedling program? And then how many are you planning to plant this year? Because I hear that it might be a bit of a record-breaking year.
It is a bit of a record-breaking year, and we can talk about this later on, but this year we're actually on track to plant a record-breaking 200,000 trees. So every year, South Nation Conservation plants about 150,000 on average across our watershed jurisdiction in Eastern Ontario, in partnership with private property owners and our member municipalities, including the city of Clarence Rockland. So as I said, this year we are on track to plant a record-breaking 200,000 trees, which is the most trees we have ever planted in a single season. I believe before this, it was about 190,000 in 1993. And it's important to note that about 20,000 of those will be in the city of Clarence Rockland. And since 1991, South Nation Conservation has planted over 3.3 million trees locally. So what's special about working with a conservation authority to undertake your planting project is that you could be eligible to receive various subsidies. And we also provide professional and technical expertise to help best determine planting location on your property and species selection. Unfortunately, our stock is completely allocated for the 2021 season, but if anyone is interested in undertaking a planting project on their property in 2022, they are still encouraged to contact us this year and early, and we would be happy to get that process started.
That's great to hear. Just like the festival season, you've got to get it the year beforehand, otherwise things sell out super quickly. So great to hear that it's doing so well. And as you say, we'll come on to the wider tree program at some point further down the line. I'm sure you and I and some people will catch up about it, hopefully in person, seeing some of this tree planting. But going back to the seedling, the community giveaway one, how would you categorize a successful year within it? Like what are you hoping to achieve?
Yeah, well, this year we're on track to distribute 10,000 free trees to residents through the community free tree giveaway program to help improve our local forest cover and get more trees in the ground. And obviously this is a very passionate subject for us and a lot of residents throughout Prescott and Russell and Clarence Rockland. If all goes according to plan, we don't expect to have any leftover trees at the end of it. And as the demand for trees right now is very high. And as I said earlier, we're also on track as a conservation authority to plant over 200,000 trees locally this spring. So that in itself is a huge accomplishment as we work and we strive to increase and improve and protect our local forest cover. And also, this is important, the more trees we plant, the more unique benefits that we can reap from them. Trees have several benefits. They add aesthetic appeal, provide shade to your property, and can even increase property values. Plus, planting trees is a great way, as I said, to enhance local forest cover and also help reduce erosion if they're planted near a water course.
So as you hinted at earlier, it's not a case of if you apply for this and you get it for your household, you have to drive 25 kilometers down the road to go plant it. You could pop it up in your front garden, your back garden. It's still worthwhile to have them in these urban areas.
Absolutely. I mean, they are seedlings for now, but they don't stay as seedlings forever. So, I mean, I still would recommend planting them in a location that is appropriate on your property, in your backyard, that's maybe further away from your home or however you see fit, because eventually if they do take and they grow to be big and strong, that is something to consider for, yourself or the future owner of the home, but absolutely they can be planted in urban areas. And we would encourage that as well. You know, if you're hoping to see a little more green space in your neighborhood, for sure.
Well, that's great. Yeah, you don't want to have to plant the tree, look after it, nurture it, let it grow, and then have to chop it down at the end.
No, we wouldn't like to see that.
So, Taylor, just casting our minds at the end here a little bit further forward, when do these seedlings arrive in the municipalities, and when do you know when the process to apply for them is open for residents?
Yeah, so residents can apply right now for a chance to receive their free bundle of seedlings. All that they have to do is visit our website at nation.on.ca and complete the online form. The seedlings will be available if you were selected to receive a bundle of seedlings. They will be available for a pickup at a safe curbside pickup location within the municipality, to be determined sometime in early May.
Okay, well, fantastic. Taylor, thank you so much for taking your time to speak to us today. And hopefully we see some seedlings popping up all over the municipality in the next couple of months.
For sure. Thanks for having me, Thomas.
Cheers.
As we sit on the verge of a third lockdown, a lot of people will be casting their minds towards the kind of effects that it might have, especially for our small local businesses who have struggled so much during the past 12 months. Many initiatives were set up over the course of last year from the United Counties of Prescott Russell and even the City of Clarence Rockland with their hashtag CRLocal to try and encourage us to keep purchasing and keeping these mum and pop stores, as we call them, alive and well. But they've taken another boost this week as the council voted in favour to approve $4,000 to go to the local Chamber of Commerce here in Clarence Rockland to try and aid with advertising and promoting of small businesses, a move that Councillor Mario Zant wanted to make sure was accessible to all.
I know that this is incredibly important, obviously, for our city, but I just want to make sure that obviously this would cover businesses that are already in the Chamber of Commerce. It's important to make sure that the Chamber of Commerce reaches out to all businesses in the city to make sure that they are included in this. I would hate for them to think that, you know, the Chamber of Commerce is getting public funds to try to help businesses, local businesses. However, if they're not in the Chamber of Commerce, then they would be left out. So I think it's important to make sure that we communicate that effectively, that all businesses in the city are welcome to this, and all businesses should contact the Chamber of Commerce in order to benefit from this.
Okay, thank you. Monsieur Cardellini? Monsieur Lalonde, après.
Thank you, Councillor Zant, for bringing that up. I think it's important to mention. I believe that was their intention as discussed at their AGM, but it's good to get it out there. And I think with this new group running and steering the Chamber of Commerce, I think great things are going to happen. So again, thank you to Ali for our economic development and Helen to work on this campaign so that we can help them take the reins and go with it. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Towards the start of the Committee of the Whole meeting, a motion was proposed by Councillor Mario Zant and seconded by Councillor Carl Grimard, looking to improve the safety of the pedestrian crossways along Highway 17 in Clarence Rockland. Four upgrades were proposed, though the changes would actually need to be put in place by the United Counties of Prescott and Russell. But fortunately, Mayor Guy Desjardins, who sits on that council, was very much in favour for the move as well, as he stated in the meeting that he'd received some very similar complaints from residents about the safety of those pedestrian crossways. The changes would see the implementation of something known as leading pedestrian intervals, which allow for the pedestrian crossing to turn green prior to the green light going for vehicles coming in the other direction, allowing pedestrians to enter the road beforehand, and anyone who wants to turn left or right and cross the pedestrian path is already aware of the pedestrians coming across, which statistically has shown it is safer. There are 9 new volunteer firefighters in our region as the council voted in favour for the formality version of approving them to start up their duties. This is an application process that you may recall started in October last year, and this week we got the opportunity to pop down to the Clarence Rockland Fire Department to speak to one of these new volunteers and to find out a little bit about the application process, what inspired them and what their family thinks of them taking up such a brave role.
Hello and welcome back to TVC 22. We are here at the Clarence Rockland Fire Department speaking to one of the newly hired volunteer firefighters. How are you, Patrick?
I'm fine, thank you.
That's good. So let's get right into it. So can you tell us what is a volunteer firefighter?
It's basically someone who volunteers their work for the fire department here in Rockland that basically works after hours. I know they have full-time firefighters during the day, so after hours is mainly manned by volunteers.
So can you go into a little more detail what's the difference between a career firefighter and a volunteer firefighter?
As far as I understand, the training is, if not the same, it's very similar. But I think it's the fact that you're employed part-time rather than full-time.
Yeah, so what were some of the reasons that you wanted to become a volunteer firefighter?
It's always something that's interested me. I've always enjoyed giving my time to the community. I know I've been a hockey trainer for my son for the past 5 years on his hockey team. I've coached baseball in Rockland and Wendover. But I've never had the time to give my time for volunteer firefighting because it's not the same as giving your time for a baseball season. I mean, it's part-time, but it's still very time-consuming. Mm-hmm. And I'm at a point in my life where I do have the time now, and I saw a posting, and I applied, and here I am.
Yeah, so do you have, like, a lot of support from your family, from your friends? What did they say when you decided to become
definitely.
A volunteer?
Definitely. I mean, it was a huge conversation that I did have with my wife and my son because, I mean, it's not just a sacrifice that I'm giving, it's also a sacrifice that they have to live with as well, because I could be gone any time of the day or during the night, right? So, I mean, the support there is phenomenal, as well as my friends, and I mean, my work is very supportive of what I do too.
Perfect, yeah. So could you tell us if you need any prior training before?
The only thing that was required to start the process of the first firefighter course and the first responder first aid was the standard first aid. So no.
Okay, I see. So can you describe what the training is like?
I haven't been through it yet, okay. But what I understand, it is about 200 hours of training before I actually start answering calls. I have to do a first responder first aid. There's firefighter one and two. I'm enrolled in the firefighter one the whole month of June, which runs Friday, Saturday, and Sunday the entire month. So it is very time, time. It takes a lot of time, but and it's the same training as a full-time firefighter as well.
Yeah, so you're one of the 9 nominees, yeah?
Yeah, I am one of the 9. I think we started off being 14 or 15 during the process, and they chose 9 for the 3 different stations.
When you started the application process, what were some of the things that you needed to go through?
They started with having a information session for ourselves and for our families, just if we had questions, and I mean, it answered a lot of the questions my wife had that I couldn't answer. And then once you apply, if you get chosen, then you have a written test to do, a physical test, and then if you pass those, then you get an interview.
What were some of the things that you were tested on both tests?
The written test was half the questions were English, half were French. They were on typical firefighter questions, very specific, and then they were on some of the tools and some of the safety to see if you could answer properly on safety measures like ladders and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. The physical test was it was different stations, and I mean it went from everything from going up and down stairs to going through a little course that they have built where you couldn't see out and you had to get out. There was different compartments in the course, to going up a ladder, to pulling a dummy from one end to the other of the garage. So, mm-hmm.
So basically, they're just recreating scenarios that you might come across.
Exactly.
In this situation.
Yeah, they're putting you through physical exertions to see how you take that, and they were also testing for claustrophobia when you were going through the holes, and if you could stay safe going up and down a ladder. It was a safety and a physical kind of test.
Mm-hmm. So, do you know how well your other classmates did?
I'm not sure.
Not sure.
No. I mean, because of COVID measures, I know that the fire hall had a hard time initiating the process. It kept getting pushed back for obvious reasons, and they did a really good job at keeping everyone safe. But by doing that, we didn't see the others go through the course, right? So it was very individualized.
And so, how much time have you already had to commit to just the training and just to learning?
Right now, other than the tests and the interview, like I said before, the month of June is pretty much reserved for training. So when training comes, we go. I mean, mm-hmm. And COVID's not helping the cause, right? But they're doing a really good job at trying to get the process going as much as they can.
So you'll do the training in the summer, right? And then from then on, you'll just kind of keep doing training sessions as they come, just to keep your skills up to...
Exactly. I mean, they do have training sessions twice a month, from what I believe. And I can't answer calls until I actually do all my training. So me answering calls is not going to happen until another 6-7 months.
Why do you think someone should become a volunteer firefighter?
I mean, if it's something that interests you and you need and you like to help your community and stuff like that, and you have extra time, because it is time consuming. Mm-hmm. I mean, you can't become a volunteer firefighter and expect to only answer one call on 10, right? So it's a balance between your home life, your work, and then your volunteer position.
So when you're done your training, have you thought about becoming a career firefighter as well?
No. Firefighting as a career has never been on my mind. I've always wanted to be a volunteer firefighter, mm-hmm. but I have a good job now, so I'm happy where I am. So, mm-hmm. Other than helping my community out, that's where my interest was.
So, what's one thing that people should know about being a volunteer firefighter, just so they kind of know your story?
I mean, I think the biggest thing is that be ready to give your time. Like I said, just the training is 200 hours, so. That's not even counting calls, right? So if you're not ready to give time and to put effort in, then it's probably not the avenue to take.
Perfect. I want to thank you for your time, Patrick. That is all we have for today. Thanks for tuning in. This is Bruce of the Crew signing off.
And casting our minds towards the future, now the city of Clarence Rockland was looking at next year and the municipal elections and the way in which people can vote. As the province and the rest of the world continue to thrive forward towards more of an online and electronic world, there was support amongst the council to retain some alternative methods of casting your ballot. Madame Wallet of the administration of the city of Clarence Rockland did reassure the councillors, though, that even if we move all of the ballots to an online process, there will still be in-person voting booths where people can get aid if they're not so comfortable with the technology. So that's it for this first summary report. We'll be trying to bring you an episode whenever there is one of these local council meetings, whether they be your normal regular ones that occur about every 2 weeks, or maybe even a special committee of the whole meeting that pops up here and there. Let us know in the comments if you've enjoyed it, if something you want to see. As I said, this is really just some like key highlights, some things we've picked out and tried to grab an interview or two around. So if you do want to get the full picture, do make sure you at least check out the agendas, which can be found in the description. And the bulk of this program really concentrated on part 3 of the live broadcast. Again, you can find a link to that video in the description. So thank you very much for watching. Goodbye.